the line how patient their record label were, because nowadays you get two singles and you're out the door. You know, we're two albums in, no sign of a hit record, no sign of the scene appearing, and the label's still prepared to give them another album.
But one thing to also note, at the time of making this record, is half the budget was spent on drugs. So this was obviously starting to set in and become something of a problem, which it would later develop to be a big problem.
Still hard at it on the LA scene, band manager Lindy Gertz started to line up out-of-town gigs to make them more than just an LA oddity. They had over a year of touring ahead of them. They played a couple of dates with Run DMC, then they started headlining nationally, before heading to Europe, where they played a clutch of shows, hitting the UK for the first time. Much to Flea's relief, Jack Irons accepted the invitation to rejoin the band.
Well, they built a reputation of being like a very over-the-top live act, and there's plenty of sex going on. And I think in the early to mid-80s, it was fairly sexless in hip-hop music. You look at New Romantics, and they're not very sexy, as you know. There's no dirty sex going on there. With the Chili Peppers, there was plenty of that going on and off the stage. The songs are about sex, every single type of sex. It's a key part of the whole persona, is that sex and energy, good times. It's what the whole the Chili Peppers thing is about. Not very many, very clothes, like, you know, waving it all out. I mean, that was very important to the Chili Peppers thing, you know. It's the dirtiness of funk, you know, the sexuality of funk, mixed with the frat boy mentality of growing up as a white boy in Los Angeles. And yeah, it's a fairly potent brew, and it's one that was working.
If you listen back, no matter what album it's from, you can always get that sort of great, exciting energy from them. It's just, you know, it's never been focused at this point in their career to where it should be focused.
The band now went in to record their third album, Uplift Mofo Party Plan. They started rehearsals in EMI's rooms on Sunset. The first day they arrived with only five completed songs, producer Michael Beinhorn hit the roof. Extensive touring had taken its toll on creativity, but Beinhorn made them shape up, got them into a routine, and generally imposed the structure they really needed at this point to get the album done.
They needed someone to say, look, you know, okay, you're pissing away, you know, thousands and millions of pounds of major record company money, and you can't keep doing this. You will just get dumped, and you'll be, you know, regretting it for the rest of your lives. You know, get in there, write some goddamn songs, you know, make an album that makes some form of sense, and stop twatting about. And they obviously respected him enough to hear this and do it, which I don't think makes it, you know, a classic album by any means, but at least with something like Fight Like a Brave, for example, you got it.
So much more feeling to it. That was like the others, it was kind of a bit hectic. This one, it just sort of sat a lot better, and because of this, they're more comfortable in what they're playing, the songs are coming out better, the whole process is smoother.
The first track really that came out off of that Uplift Mofo Party Plan was Fight Like a Brave, which is just this absolutely crazy punk, funk, rock, rap record, and the video is just totally insane as well. I mean, Anthony Kiedis is like dressed up as some kind of Native American Indian with like a feathered headdress and war paint and all sorts, and then they're kind of marching like soldiers. It's a totally insane video. It was just made for MTV, really, although it wasn't shown at the time on MTV. And there was just nothing else like it, and I think that was one of the things that attracted a lot of the people who were listening to the Chili Peppers at that time, which was the UK underground, because they certainly weren't a mainstream act at that stage.
There is still that underlying pin of the drug problems, which, you know, perhaps might fuel the kind of wacky side of it a little bit, or a lot even, but at the same time it's taking away, causing underlying problems between different band members, and, you know, generally just causing havoc.
I mean, Fight Like a Brave was written about basically Hillel and Anthony's drug problems. It was all about how they were fighting like braves, trying to battle against this whole heroin thing. And it was one of the strong tracks off of the album.
All the hallmarks of what makes the Chili Peppers great are already on the album. You know, you've got the fantastic rhythm section, the great grooves, the kind of the little rapping vocals going on there. There's a little rap influence coming in here now. Some good songs and everything. It's a really great party record, and it's a party record that lifts them up a couple of levels in America. And they become, and the alternative scene is also getting bigger by then, because what people forget is in the mid-80s, the alternative scene was tiny, you know. People used to say, oh yeah, Sonic Youth have got a real breakthrough record here, they'll sell 20,000, you know. To be a big alternative band in the 80s didn't mean you were in the top 10 in the album charts. It meant you were getting 500 people at your gigs. It was different. Till Nirvana came along, the alternative scene was pretty small, you know. So the Chili Peppers getting with that album, they get towards the top of a small scene. The alternative scene really was alternative then.
Uplift Mofo Party Plan was easily the band's strongest work to date. Yet despite the artistic success of the album, EMI decided it wasn't doing very well commercially and sent the Chili's on tour again. Uplift Mofo Party Plan was the last record the band would make with their childhood friend. Back in L.A., the sometime painter and guitarist who defined the band's sound, and still in many ways continues to today, overdosed on heroin and died in his apartment on Saturday, June 27, 1988. On Monday, a friend found Hillel's body. He had only been 26 years old.
Anthony and Hillel had been on the road touring with the band for the Uplift Mofo Party Plan album, and they had managed to stay pretty much clean. After the tour, Hillel was like, I've got to go back on it, because he was really starting to feel rough. He'd been going cold turkey. The band had been doing press in hotels and stuff whilst they were on tour, and Hillel was just so sick that he had to stay in his room. So it was basically Jack Irons and Anthony and Flea doing all the interviews whilst Hillel was just cold turkeying in hotel rooms. So literally when he came off the tour, he was like, I need my smack again. And the story basically goes that they'd come off the tour, Hillel gone back to his flat, and he died, and it took until the Monday for his body to actually be found when a friend phoned up to see how he was. And the kind of guilt that hit the band was just crazy.
I think people generally assume that, you know, that happens and then they say, right, let's clean up our act, let's, you know, get on with this. But in fact, it ended up spiralling Anthony Kiedis worse and worse into heavier and heavier drug use and denial about the drug use, which continued up until 2000, which a lot of people think that he kind of stopped that back in the early days, but it didn't. It kept on rolling.
I think the truth is, it's a really, really unfortunate thing that happened, and that obviously that would make his friends and bandmates, because they were both, you know, it's easy to forget that, look at their own lifestyle, and obviously ask themselves the question, was there something that they could have seen and done to change it? But the truth of the matter is, you know, that is the risk you take when you sink into that drug lifestyle. That is the risk everyone takes. They may not wake up the next day.
The thing about Hillel is that he's just a friend of ours who we love dearly, who contributed so much to our existences and shaping the way that we think and the way that we act. And he was just a really beautiful person who we were extremely close to, who we shared, you know, an infinite amount of, like, soulful, deep, fun, all kinds of experiences together. We grew up together, just sharing everything together, and we loved him. You know, I mean, he's the one that got me to play bass. He's the one that turned me on to so many things, and both of us, you know. He's just someone that we loved very much, and now he's gone, and it's just terrible, and there's not a day that goes by where either of us don't think about him. And I just miss him, you know, but I, you know, it's a double-edged thing, because at the same time that it depresses the hell out of me, makes me so sad that he's gone, at the same time I'm just feel lucky that I got to know him at all, ever.